temperaments, which Heblicker humbly attributes to the association with producer and psychoanalyst Dr. Ashok Pai. Being an environmentalist himself, his movies depict nature and conservation. He is the winner of the State Award for these movies, Hagatha, National and State Awards for his Kadina Benki, and the prestigious International Osiris Award for his Shepherds on the Move. Heblicker has directed many movies and also acted in most of them. As an environmentalist, Mr. Suresh Heblicker has worked with Agricultural Bank for 1 year in Bangalore after his post-graduation and the World Bank projects. He has shown great concern and interest in promoting preserving the environment. He has been working for many years spreading the message about importance of the environment and in different parts of Karnataka. To popularize the subject of environment, he produced nearly 20 short and documentary films on various subjects like water, solar energy, greening the barren lands, alternative sources of energy, importance of Western Ghats, one of the biodiversity hotspots in the world. He has delivered several lectures at colleges, universities, and other social and educational institutions, along with many presentations and discussions with varied participants to create awareness among them to value the nature. Mr. Suresh Heblicker set up an environmental organization called Eco Watch in 1998, which is very active in the area of afforestation, biodiversity conservation, water conservation, environmental education, and other natural resource conservation. EcoWatch organizes workshops and seminars on ecological and environmental topics and other related subjects. The organization works with schools, corporate, and government agencies. Mr. Keen to promote the concept of small towns as eco-friendly entities and destinations. He also writes regularly on the subject of environment and development to various newspapers and magazines, both in English and Kannada, on contemporary issues. He also appears regularly on the regional TV channels, voicing concerns on the environmental issues and conservation. So he has won several awards for his excellent contributions in the field of both film as well as environmental conservation. He received award for his work in the field of environmental conservation, education, and also his outstanding performance through his NGO called Eco Watch. The award is Rajiv Gandhi Environment Award, given by Government of Karnataka. So he received Citizen Extraordinaire Award, Rotary International, Bangalore, towards comprehensive outreach on environment and developmental issues. He received a prestigious United Nations Osiris FAO Award in 2002 for his excellent documentary that is Shepherds on the Move. He also received Paul Aris Fellowship given by the Rotary International towards promoting environmental cause through bridge cinemas, documentaries, and other contemporary approaches. And other awards including IBM and PRSI Award, Kempegowda Award, Government of Karnataka, and most noteworthy award is that Rajyotsava Award given by Karnataka State Government for his contributions to the development and environmental conservation of Karnataka. Currently, we are honored to have him as a member of the Board of Governors, HISEC. I wish him all the best. So this is a brief introduction about Mr. Suresh Heblicker, but he has done extraordinary work in the field of both film and environmental conservation. Please excuse me, sir, if I left out something and because of time constraints. Yes, sir. Yeah. Thank you so much, Professor Rajshekar.
Thank you very much, Professor Krishnadas, for that excellent introduction to the speaker. That sets the now the stage for us to listen to you, sir. So we request you to address.
Yeah, ellarigu namaskara. ನನಗೆ ಈ ಇವತ್ತು ಬರೋಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಮುಂಚೆ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ರಾಜಶೇಖರ್ ಅವ್ರು ಕೇಳಿದ್ರು, ನೀವು ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಿರೋ ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತೀರಾ ಅಂತ. ನಾನು ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಹೇಗೆ ಬೇಕೋ ಹಾಗೆ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತೇನೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದೆ. ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲೇ ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಬೆಟರು ಅಂದೆ. ಇಲ್ಲ, ನಮ್ಮ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಭಾಷೆ ಮಾತನಾಡೋರು ಬಹಳಷ್ಟು ಜನ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, ಸೊ ನೀವು ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷಲ್ಲಿಯೂ ಮಾತಾಡಿ ಅಂತ. ಸೊ ನಿಮಗೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ ನನ್ನ ಕರೆದಿದ್ದಕ್ಕೆ. ಅದು ಕೂಡ ಇವತ್ತು ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಇದು ರಾಜ್ಯೋತ್ಸವ ಇದಲ್ವಾ, ರಾಜ್ಯೋತ್ಸವ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟೆನ್ಷನ್ ಲೆಕ್ಚರ್ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ನಾನು ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದ ಬಗ್ಗೆನೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಹೇಳಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ರೀತಿಯಿಂದ ಮುಂಚೆ ಅದೇ ತರ ಲೆಕ್ಚರ್ಸ್ ಇರ್ತಿದ್ವು. ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ ಕನ್ನಡ ಸಾಹಿತ್ಯ, ಕನ್ನಡದ ಪದ್ಯ, ಪೋಯೆಟ್ರಿ, ಸಿನಿಮಾ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ನಾನು ಕೇಳಿಲ್ಲ. ಬಟ್ ನಾನು ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಇವತ್ತು ಮಾತನಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರೋದು ನಿಮ್ಮ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟ್ ನಲ್ಲಿ ಅನ್ನಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ನನಗೆ. ಸೊ ಈ ರೀತಿಯಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಸಿನಿಮಾಕ್ ಬರೋದು ಒಂದು ಆಕ್ಟರ್ ಆಗಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಬರಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಐ ಡಿಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ಎಂಟರ್ ದ ಫಿಲ್ಮ್ ಇಂಡಸ್ಟ್ರಿ ಟು ಬಿಕಮ್ ಅನ್ ಆಕ್ಟರ್. ಇಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ಎಲ್ಸ್ ಟು ಡೂ, ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಐ ವಾಸ್ ಸ್ಟಡಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಿಟಿ ವೆನ್ ವೈಸ್ ಚಾನ್ಸಲರ್ ಪಾವಟೆ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಇನ್ ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ದಿ ಐ ಡೋಂಟ್ ನೋ ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಅ ಸ್ಟ್ರಾಂಗ್ ಸೆನ್ಸ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ದಿ ರೂರಲ್ ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಿಟಿ he wanted them to be exposed to the better faculty, you know, who are working abroad. So he invited a lot of professors who were teaching in US, teaching in Germany, England, France, so that such, you know, students could be they could have the advantage of listening to these professors and all that. So I remember when I was doing my economics that Professor Shah and Professor Dikshet, Professor Hiremat, and one professor, the man who was teaching in Paris for 30 years, Mahale, Professor G.K. Mahale, you know, he came from Paris. So he came to teach French almost about 35, 40 years ago. So when he had organized a workshop, When I met him and when I saw him, I was quite impressed because it was a dawn of culture, music, literature, arts, history, philosophy. And he would speak, you know, impromptu in the sense on any of these subjects whenever he was asked to. And he was a man who had organized a film workshop. And that was a time when we did not know what film workshop meant and what it was. So I was a little confused what it film workshop meant for me. But because we were exposed to only Hindi films and English films in Dharwar, because there was only one theater which used to receive Kannada films, and once in a way we would see if there was a good Kannada film, we would go also and see the Kannada films. I remember having seen Krishna Garudi, Maestro, and one Puttanna Kannagal's film. I forget the title of it. However, so these were the kind of days when we grew up watching Hindi and the English movies in Dharwar. And that's what I was telling Professor Rajshekar a little while ago. And that was when I came to Bangalore after my MA, I was really struck by looking at the Planet movies, which were made by Carl Sagan. Carl Sagan was an astronaut, he was a scientist, and an extremely brilliant person when he talked about how the Earth, how the Earth was born, and how the various constituents of the earth, like biodiversity, plants, human beings, and so on, which were there on this earth, how they were evolved over millions of years. And he spoke about Charles Darwin, he spoke about the space, and that really fascinated me. He would speak about how 300 million light years one has to travel from one galaxy to another, and what the stars consisted of, gas and dust and intense heat which lighted up the stars. So this was a very fascinating thing. And later he came to botany, later he came to the heritages of the earth, like the great historical places, historical monuments. He would go there, sit there, and he would explain how these things, you know, for instance, for the first time, the shadow from Alexandria to a place in Egypt. He said there were two sticks on a map, and one stick would have a very small shadow, the other stick would have a longer shadow. And because he said, how could it be? Because both the sticks were of the same height, but the shadows were of different length. Why there was? So he folded the map. He said, look, the earth is, we have the earth, which is bent in the sense we have a global earth. And so it is a round earth, which was proved later, which was long back, about 400 years ago, Galileo had said about that. So these were the kings and the queens and the great emperors. And he said, how many of them spilled their blood, which the rivers contained and ran? But what happened to the earth? He says the earth is the same. It moves with the same motions. It moves with the same rivers and the valleys and so on. He said, people fight here. People keep on doing so many things. They have ambitions. They have great ideologies. But all of them, with their death, they just pass away. For instance, he said, even Hitler was there. He wanted to conquer the whole world, but he died a miserable death. So was Mussolini in Italy. He had imagined, he had conceived great plans in his mind that he would conquer the world, he would conquer Europe first. But then he lived a life which was not accepted by the people. But since these people had greater ideologies of the world, they were, they were fine if they really pursued them. But people, naturally, you cannot, suppress their feelings or voices for a long time. So he said that nothing lasts long on this earth. You know, there were a lot of spiritual and philosophical ideas which he put into these planets and all that. So these were the things almost 30 years ago, 1970. They said there are 50,000 nuclear appliances, nuclear arsenals in the world. And if they all get burst up, what will happen to the world? The world will survive. The planet will survive. Maybe certain things may be burnt, for instance, with your nuclear explosion. But the planet will survive. Lord Attenborough, who started making great films on this earth. I mean, why I'm saying this is, my ideas of environment came from these films only. Because such beautiful animals, such beautiful wildlife, such wonderful oceans, and the great valleys and the rivers, endless rivers, soft bending rivers, and the grasslands that moved for miles and miles, and the tiny micro pictures of ants and all that, why they are there, how they function, what they do, all these things created a great impression on our mind. And the ideas of films, as I was saying, when for the first time Professor Mahale organized a film workshop in Karnataka University, I went to see the films. I was aghast because there are films made so tremendously differently from the kind of films that we were watching. The kind of films in India which were made were good. I'm not saying that they were bad. But, I mean, our understanding of the films was much different. We grew up, as I said, watching these Hindi films, English films, mostly the Hollywood films. But the French films, like, for instance, The Wages of Fear, made by Costa Gavras, was about the Second World War. And then Hitler had launched his Second World War in 1939 or so. And there was a conscription in Europe. That is, you are compulsory, the mandate is to go to the military, serve for 2 years, whoever you are, once you attain the age of 18. You have to serve for 2 years. You may be a son of the prime minister, managing director of a company, whatever. But you have got to go. That was a mandate. But there were about four youngsters. And these youngsters were all artists. One was a poet, one was a writer, one was a cartoonist. And they said, why should we take the gun, go to the war and kill enemies? They are not our enemies. They have also, you know, sisters and mothers and brothers like we have. Why we should kill them, take the gun. And instead of that, we can spend the time doing our own, pursue our own art. That's nearly 5 years. But then they say that the entire Europe, including America, came under this ban of, provision of this conscription of 2 years. So you have to go to a place where that provision does not work, in the sense where you are not caught. So they find out one of the most small backward countries in Latin America. And they collect some money, you know, through their friends and family. And then they hire a small, they go to with a small plane, they reach the Latin American country and spend their 5 years. They don't know the culture, they don't know the language, they don't have much money, and they don't have enough skills also, because they were all, as I told you, artists, poets, that kind of sensitive people they were. This was made by Costa Gavra. He's a great French filmmaker. And they're amazing. I'm not telling you all the details. In case you have not seen it, I would like you to see that. Because the way the film was made, made a tremendous impact on my mind. And all the films that I had seen before that had no meaning for me. I mean, they stood nowhere. Here, there are two trucks. There are unmotorable roads. And then 5 years are over. They just spend, you know, doing small work here and there, like carpentry or, you know, carrying all kinds of work, because they don't have friends. Nobody knows them there. So they are compelled to do the kind of work which, you know, it's okay for them. So when the war is over, they cannot go back because they don't have money to go by, because they are almost 300 kilometers away from New York. So there is an oil magnate. And he comes with his jeep and he announces the wages. He says, those who can drive and carry my oil to New York, to the refinery, I will pay $2,000. So that was the wage of beer. So he said $2,000 was big money those days. So if we get $2,000, we can buy the ticket and a lot of money will remain with us. And that's all. So four of them, they say, but then there is a demonstration. They are taken to a depot, where they show that the oil is so explosive, a drop falls and it makes a huge sound like a bomb. So it is so very, dangerous. So the truck is packed with, jam-packed with every other can of that oil. And they say that if you jostle it too much, then it will burst. And the whole thing, surrounding forest, surrounding anything, that will be burnt. And people will not be able to see your cinders also. So that kind of a fear is there. So this is a fear of wages. And then how they drive, how they reach there. One truck gets burnt after about 10 minutes. Only one truck remains. There is a very tough, determined fellow who wants to go back to his place because he has promised his mother that he will come back and meet her. And then he has a girlfriend to whom he has given his in a commitment that he will come and marry her. So all these ideas are there. He reaches New York and then he gets $2,000. He's coming back to deliver the truck. And then he's gay abandoned, in the sense he's very happy. He's thinking about his girlfriend. He's thinking about his friends and all that kind of thing. Then there is a small flash of a local girl who was working in a hotel. Why I'm saying this is, these are the small little things which make a tremendous impact on you. And then she's serving, she's cleaning the table, she just puts a cup of tea before him. That's all, small flashes. He remembers her more intensely. And we think that, oh, what a nice girl. Perhaps, you know, he should really go and meet her. I mean, the kind of impression the director creates in you. So why I'm saying these are the films which made great impact on us. We were also seeing some of the Chaplin films. Chaplin was called as a genius by Mahatma Gandhi. Because Mahatma Gandhi, I don't know whether he had seen movies when he was studying in England or what, but he was the only man whom he had met. If there is any genius in film industry, and I consider that is Chaplin, he said. Well, Chaplin, I understood, was a man for masses and also class. He made film for class and mass. because anybody could go. They were silent films. He made films on such wide range of subjects, like from family to wars, like, you know, The City Lights, a blind girl. You know, he's in love with her and he wants to see that she's cured of her ailment. Then there is Modern Times. Modern Times is so complex a movie. He created those machines and he created the human beings like artificial intelligence today. If you take two pictures, what would be the third picture? If you do this, what will be the future? They are just like the artificial intelligence would tell you. Similarly, at that time, he created Modern Times in such a way, and he gave us, you know, he gave us certain indications that how human beings will be in terms of their health, in terms of their vision, in terms of their clothes, in terms of their, you know, ideas. And from there, he makes a film called Dictator. Dictator, there is a chance that there is a whole army sitting, listening to some speeches and all that. Then he suddenly inspired in his mind, listening to a certain to a speaker, and he begins to hate Hitler in such a way that he stands and gives a tremendous speech. It is a one-shot movie. Why I'm saying this is, there is a film called Bottom Ship Potemkin, made by a Russian called, but it is such a remarkable film that each shot makes an impression on you, because each shot is considered, conceptualized in such a way how long it should stay on the screen. Because on the screen, what we have is a series of still photographs which keep running, what is called a persistence vision. This vision of persistence, that is, they persist moving, and then they create an impression. They give you a feeling that you are seeing something present, even if it has happened in the history. When you look at a movie now, you feel that you are looking it now. It is happening now. That is the magic of the film. And the films have to be taken enormously seriously by the world, was proved by great French filmmakers. Like as I said, Costa Gavra, there are film directors like Franca Truffaut, who was a great poet, was a great writer, a journalist. He wrote books. He was the first man who wrote a book on Alfred Hitchcock. Alfred Hitchcock was only considered as a suspense filmmaker by the world. He made great films, no doubt. But how he made such great films and he caught the attention and the mind of the entire audience of the world was explained by Franca Truffaut. Truffaut said his editing is something remarkable, because basically he was an engineer. This Alfred Hitchcock was an engineer, and he would measure the time that would stay on the mind of a person who is watching the film so long, and he would cut it to another visual that will persist, that will also carry on, that will extend the same impact. Suppose you see now some particular one shot, one scene, and then suddenly some other scene comes. It may quell, or it may intercept, or it may disturb your vision. But here, Hitchcock kept the suspense throughout the movie, because the way he edited it, the way he saw him in his mind, he brought it on the film. See, this is a great director. The way you think, now when you are writing a screen, you know, screenwriting, screenplay, that screenplay is in such that it is brought on in your mind, and the same thing has to be there on the film. This is a remarkable, you know, ingenuity, but I say. So such were the great filmmakers, like for instance, John Griffith in America, 1902, a film to the moon. It was a remarkable movie. I was talking about Battleship Potemkin. It is even today supposed to be the one of the best films made in the world because of this editing, photography, sound, because film is a very complex medium. It's complex because it involves so many other arts, like not only your camera, it involves technicians like editing, screenplay, actors and performers, and then light and sound, music, and all has to be brought into, it has to be integrated into the film. How do you do that? With a particular sound level? These are all technical details anyway. So as directors, if they know these things, for instance, Chaplin was great. He would understand everything. He was great in terms of his thinking also, because there is a film which I don't remember the name, but there is a boy, and he himself acted in many of the movies. What I felt about Chaplin was, he was a poor man. He came from a slum of England, and he would put everything, what he saw in the film, what he saw in life, he brought it on the film. Whereas we people, I mean, we are the fellows, we are looking at films and we make films. We look at many films, we think we will have our own idea, our own story, and we start living and then make a film. This should not, I mean, we have to bring in, that's, we lack imagination there. Like Einstein said, imagination is much stronger than knowledge. Okay? So if we don't have imagination, ideas, like Professor Maruti was saying, ideas are very important. So ideas and imagination should go into filmmaking. You can make any film. You can make any subject. Franca Truffaut once said that you look at the newspaper today, there are hundreds of stories. You can choose anything and make. That's not the thing. What are you good at? What can you do? What your where your heart, you know, dwells? How do you pursue something very strongly, where you feel emotionally? Commit yourself and do that. Otherwise, you know, people think I will do this, I will do that. They keep on doing it. So unfortunately, in India, except Satyajit Ray, Mrinal Sen, Hrithik Ghatak, and then we have Shyam Benegal and Girish Kasaravalli in Kannada, these are some of the great filmmakers. Even Puttanna Kangal in Kannada was a great film man. Like which films? Ranganayaki, one of the finest films made by Puttanna Kangal. Editing, small things, sound, then human emotions, acting. Everything he brought from the actors. Otherwise, they were bad actors in other films. In his film, they were good. The performance was good because his director was good. He knew that this has to be extracted from them. So one has to be extraordinarily sensitive in making the films. So these were the great filmmakers like John Griffith, David Lean. David Lean, when he made Lawrence of Arabia and Dr. Zhivago, they brought the whole world on the films. They brought the whole world on the screen. You would identify yourself anywhere. Even in, it may be happening in England. It may be happening on the deserts of Arabia. There is Franca Truffaut, this Zorba the Greek is another film. Actually, it did not score like other films, but I consider it as one of the finest films with great actors like Anthony Quinn and all that. Because Zorba brought in certain subtle and nuanced, you know, feelings of the rising young generation, because it was something about the Greek ideologies, the Greek ideas, who were, you know, as we know, Greece, they brought us, you know, feelings of democracy, Plato and all those such people. But then it also reverberated with the younger people later. The younger people were not in tune with what the Greece founders were saying. So they were very different. They were trying to go to America, like, for instance, what happened in China. For instance, China, this Italian filmmaker made a great film called The Emperor. He brought in the entire history, philosophy, thinking, culture, the mindset of Chinese in that. You imagine a prince in China who is so powerful those days, he's eventually, when the film ends, has become a gardener. He's sprinkling water on the plants along the road when the factory workers are going out of the factory. They don't even recognize him. He's just a gardener. I mean, how the change, the metamorphosis of China in terms of economic, political, social, you know, thinking and social czars, how it had transformed itself. These are films which will remain with us for a long time. That's why, unfortunately, in India, we consider films as films, oh, he's a good actor, like Amitabh Bachchan, this and that. Unfortunately, for instance, I remember this NDTV, I shouldn't have said it, they brought this Shah Rukh Khan and Amitabh Bachchan a few years ago, and they made this thing, some about 1 hour program on the tigers. And some companies gave them 4 to 8 crores of rupees. They made nothing there. neither Shah Rukh Khan nor Amitabh Bachchan know anything about tiger, anything about wildlife, anything about habitat, anything about environment. And then another Preeti Zinta, she went, picked up certain plastic, this thing from the beach of Bombay. What does it mean? See, these are the things which it doesn't happen. The great actor like Marlon Brando, the man who walked on the New York streets, he was the highest paid actor in the world. Godfather, hero. Godfather. Amazing actor. He brought in method acting. Method acting is your muscle speaks, not only your tongue. Your eye, your eyes, your muscles, your nose, your hands. You know, you speak very in a different way, in a very small, whispering way, but yet very powerful. See, these are the films which gave us ideas about what films are. Like Marlon Brando, then the Leonardo DiCaprio, the young boy who acted in that Titanic. He's such a remarkably sensitive person as far as environment is concerned. He went around the world in a small way, small boat. He walked, he went on cycle. He went to Cambodia, and he was told that a lot of forests have gone in Cambodia, because the Cambodian forests were like our Western Ghats and Himalayan forests, but the forests have been cut down. He tried to find out why. Then they said that after globalization, the economic liberalization and globalization, people started chasing the commodities, started chasing money. They were not interested in wealth. They were not interested in art, culture, history, environment, and tradition. This is what J.B.S. Haldane, the great physicist of England, who lived in India for 30 years, he wrote a book which I read, and I liked it. In that he says, in India, the future generations, at that time he said, will be chasing technologies. Technologies will bring money. But in the process, these youngsters will lose their, you know, their interest in health, interest in idea, I mean, culture, tradition, arts, poetry, painting. There will be none in them. This is what, you know, they have said. This is exactly what is happening in the developing countries. For instance, if you go to Africa and meet many of the African people, then they say that we were very good. Maybe we were living in the huts, but we are not hungry. Today we are hungry, millions of us. 811 million people in Africa were hungry last year. They went to bed only with one meal, four meals, because they said we have all been looted. A lot of our natural resources have been, you know, exploited, and they went to the Western countries. I asked this in England to a person. I said, Mr. Spencer, this is what has been said about you, even in England, in India, that a lot of our country's wealth, like wood and all that, was taken away by you. Yes, we took it, but you can always grow trees. He said, yes, we have taken wood, but you can always grow trees. What is there? It grows. But anyway, they set up what is called as a working plan. I don't know, perhaps you may be knowing. The working plan was a good plan, which was also, you know, made a film by the British people. What I'm trying to say is the British culture, I mean, the European culture or the American culture, is to preserve in solid, not only digital today, but they did collect a lot of information, a lot of details about our biodiversity, about soil, about rainfall. The 100 years of rainfall, every day how it fell, is found out actually in England. I mean, a lot of people, Indians, they brought it from there. Even as you know, perhaps you must be aware, your institute, that in 1932, for instance, the survey sheets of our revenue survey sheet were discovered, I mean, they were made only by the British. Even today, we depend on them. So some of the things I don't want to bring in there, but however, I will continue with these films. So the other films were, there was Orson Welles. This Orson Welles created a film. He was a remarkable man. He brought the whole world, like for instance, how the printing, how the wealth, how the strata of social status of a particular country, it existed, how the rulers ruled, all these things very subtly he brought in his film. He acted the role, and that film, for the first time, it exploded the minds of billions of people, like writers, socialists, I mean social thinkers and filmmakers and artists, that yeah, you have to think beyond what we have been thinking all these years, they believe. We have been thinking only in terms of how good music can be put there, how good actors can be brought, how a story can be told more brilliantly, so that the author will not be, if you are borrowing a book and basing your film on that. For instance, when Choman Dudi was made by B.B. Karan, B.B. Karan I knew personally very well for a long time. B.B. Karan was a genius in the sense he was extremely sensitive to sounds. He was the director of Bhopal, this thing. Yeah, I was invited there to give a talk on film. But then he was no more at that time. And then there were certain youngsters from Bollywood, like Bombay, Junmil. They said, "Sir, Karan was an extraordinary person. Many people mistook him. Many people misunderstood him. But he would create sound. For instance, this is there. This sound, he would use it in his music. If there were no instruments, he would find out the instruments around him. For instance, he said, look at Africa, the origin of music. See, because Africans are so good in composing, also playing and orchestrating music. It is because they lived in nature, they lived with trees, they lived with sound. That's why they were very good, extremely sensitive to these sounds and all that. So he brought a lot of these instruments which were used in Africa. And he told me once, at that time I did not understand. But later, over a period of time, I'm now trying to say why he made Choman Dudi. And he created very simple music himself. He created a music for a film which I acted called Rishashringa. That was written by Chandrasekhar Kambar. Rishashringa was a film where two national awards were given, one for photography, one for music by B.B. Karan. And he made me sing one of the, you know, the chorus songs there. That is not great, but I'm saying it. He got it for music because he sat for 36 hours. He'd never got up because he had to finish it in a studio. Prasad did not have enough money to spend on the film. So he said, we have to finish, sir, within 36 hours. He sat and used every small instrument. And he created music. It was a brilliant music, you know, when you saw, because the idea was that there were deserts, desert-like, you know, mosaics. And then we had to create music for that. There were very weird kind of music had to be created. And he understood that weirdness. And he created from the objects. So these are things why they became great filmmakers. It is not just because somebody wrote a wonderful story, somebody acted very well. No, there have been good and great actors all the time. But great films have to be made. Raj Kapoor, to a lot of extent, was a sensitive man. He made Shri 20 and Awara. Huh? Yes, they spoke of a social awareness, social reality, socio-economic. Where these socio-economic factors were very well brought about in the foreign films. For instance, Godard, when he makes films, Franca Truffo, Day for Night, and then Renoir, the French film called Hiroshima Mon Amour, is one of the most sensitive films ever made. It speaks about two young people, the Japanese girl and the American boy, who meet just because he comes to meet her husband, who was dead. Then he stays with her for a little while, they fall in love and marry. But then later what happens? Their emotional layers are different. Their emotional feelings are different. Their outlook is different on the world, on their nations. But all these things have been so beautifully brought because Renoir was a great writer himself. So it was Professor Mahale who told me why French films made a great foray into the world history, into the world literature, world classical films, because they picked up the small details. They picked up the social nuances of the society, the change. They sat in the coffee houses and began to talk discuss. That's why coffee house intellectuals, that phrase is brought down. And then they also led to the revolution of the social revolution, the political revolution. So these are the films, not like some American films come, you know, whiskey, then comes on the horse, then a kiss and all such things. You know, we clap and pay money. Not that. It is not true. We don't feel for such films because they don't reflect our socioeconomic condition, our cultural conditions. There are a lot of pretensions. That's why the actors could not become great. If you have pretensions, you have to laugh, you have to fall in love, or you have to do anything. You are not doing it, you know, you are not doing it emotionally. You are not committed to that. Your commitment comes only when there is a real situation. And a director has to create that. If he doesn't create, then actors cannot become great. That is why Mahabharata, one of the greatest films I have seen. There is no palace, no woman comes with all her, you know, with white, this thing, with jewelry. He says, when Mahabharata, about 4,000-5,000 years ago, there are no palaces. There is no ratha, there is no chariot. So they walk. Arjun and all these people walk. There were not even simple paths, you know, walking paths there. They just sleep under the trees. They sleep in some kind of dilapidated kind of houses. I mean, like huts. And they drink water from the lake. There is a woman who is from Cambodia. And Peter Brook, the director, who had served for 7 years, who went around Pakistan, Afghanistan, India, Bhutan, Nepal, and he found how Mahabharata took place here. What must have happened? If Mahabharata is not real, it must have been composed by the human imagination. But imagination also must have a certain base. There must be a certain base. So that base he found out. So Indian Institute of Management had invited me to speak on this, the creativity and my films. So I said Mahabharata is a creative film. And where I said, because here he brought the reality. And then there was a Kerala film director. He said, no, Suresh Hebblekar is wrong. He said, he's a very famous director. And because I came to know later, the directors told me that Peter Brook came to Kerala, stayed with him for 7 days. They went around, but did not contact him later. Maybe he did not get what he wanted. So he was a little upset. That was a different matter. So what I'm saying is, Peter Brook was, he said that there are certain people in the war, they die, but certain survive. Why they survive? He said, Mahabharata teaches us that there is an aura around certain individuals. And that aura protects them. That aura is an energy. It's an energy, and that energy protects them. You can't see it. But the way you feel, like if you are meditating or if you are thinking very intensely about certain things, you become very powerful. You are not scared. You can face. Yes. Wonderful. It was a film that made a tremendous impact, which was seen every day for 25 years in England and Paris. 25 years. Mahabharata. So I saw it here in India, and I spent 2 days with that director. So these were things which we have learned as how great films have been. There are many great films, like as I said, Dr. Zhivago and all that. And I may be forgetting some films. A lot of good films have been there. But my idea of environment also came from the films, like Attenborough, like Carl Sagan. Carl Sagan played a foundation for me. He was an extremely brilliant scientist, and he said right from the special, you know, constituents, he came down to earth. He said how the flowers, he said how the animals, why he said he went to Japan. And in Japan, when people were catching from the sea certain fish and crabs, on the crab there was a kind of an embossed visual which just reflected that of a Japanese warrior, you know, with his nose, with his eyes and all. Then they stopped eating that. They said, no, this says something that must be an indication for us that not to consume and destroy this species. So they threw back. They get it, they throw back into the sea. So it continues to survive. So he said, these are certain traditions in Japan and all, in many of the countries. Those traditions have to be studied. Why the traditions came? Not just because you wanted to have fun. The traditions have come from certain knowledge, from certain sources. The sources must have impacted the mind very strongly. Why they impacted you? So these are the things, you know, which Carl Sagan taught us. He said the biodiversity that you find on the earth is amazing. And there's so much of mystery. For instance, human evolution. Why we have been given so much of our hand. Hand is not only just meant for eating. Hand is also a tool, a human tool. How can it be used? What all purposes it can be put to? So these are the things which people tell us, the scientists and all that. Then I made this the psychiatry films by Dr. Ashok Pai. He was extremely interested in making films, so that he said, psychiatry cannot be just openly told to the audience, but we have millions of incidences in India. And if we can communicate through the films, make an impact on the human mind, they can come out of the houses. Because in India, if you go to a mental hospital, people will start looking at you. Then they will think you have gone mad. You see? So these are a lot of restrictions in a traditional country like ours. So we have to study the tradition of the human mind, the mindset, our culture, then make film in a way that, you know, you reach people. So my film Agatha, I mean, for instance, Kadena Benki, was such a film that it was, fortunately, a lot of critics called it, it is a film which can be seen by the children, one critic wrote. Although the film had a base on the sexual incidents of this, that is a mother fixation, the son, what is it called? Not incest, that complex, Oedipus form. Oedipus complex, it was an Oedipus complex. There are a lot of things like voyeurism is there, Oedipus complex is there. It was based on Oedipus complex to a certain extent. And it was given to some people like Karanth and Girish. They said, no, you don't want to make it. But I said, I will make it. Because I was caught by that. And that Nat D'Souza, who wrote the book on that. So I made it in such a way that people would love it. So a lot of people came, they wept. And I got nearly 1,000 letters after Kadena Benki was released. Some people thought I was a psychiatrist myself. They wrote letters to me saying they have some problems. So then I had to write back and I told Dr. Ashok Pai. And then India Today was a very prominent magazine. It wrote 3 pages on my film. And in Bombay, they 2 pages on the film edition of the newspaper. Anyway, so these were the things we have to find. The small crutches, the small nuances, the subtlety of it. And how subtlety can be visually made interesting. It can impress. Because if you keep it very subtle, it may not go and reach the audience. Right? There are things. So we have to look at our audience. Unfortunately, we have taken films only as a source of entertainment. Yeah, once upon a time when there were not many, you know, sources of entertainment, like today you can see a film on the mobile phone itself. You can see it on your TV. You can see on a car. But then there were theaters and you had to go to the theater. You had to sit the theater for 2 hours. You were in darkness. You were isolated partially from the rest of the world. So you focused what were you saying. That's why whether if the good films were there, they remained on your mind for a long time. You remember just because of this. So even today, theaters are most important because unfortunately, because of the technologies, we have a flurry of certain sources of entertainment for the people. So it should not happen. Maybe it will come back again because everything, you know, happens for a short while. When the TVs came, when the first TVs came, when the editor of a particular magazine wrote, he saw it for hours and hours, but then he got so fed up, he closed the TV, he went back to writing. So there are a lot of such things which happen. Our mind is the most important thing. films have to be taken more seriously. And I'm happy that your institute has invited me, because socio-economic institute has a tremendous role to play in the country, as far as I'm concerned. Not only because I studied the economic, but I feel that our life is wrapped by the social and economic conditions of a society. Whatever we are today, it is because of our socio-economic condition. Our personalities, our meetings, our talks, our behavior, everything depends on the kind of social layers that we have and the economic conditions that prevail around us. They determine our character, our talk, whatever. So I'm glad that I was able to speak whatever I could. I mean, I can go on talking like that. But thank you, sir. Thank you very much for inviting me. And anything if you want to ask, I am ready to answer.
Thank you very much, sir. That was wonderful address, wonderful lectures on how you came down from the great films to your own film, and then current status of the films. Okay, and how the great films provided the many details, and then also brought out to the social messages in subtle but not so subtle manner. And then Cardinal Binky, and then to current films. That was a very good journey. And now I would like to invite our chairperson, Professor Sukhdev Thorat, to provide his remarks.
Let us have some questions if they have. Yeah. Later, we will talk to Professor Thorat. He likes some questions.
Yeah, but afterwards, we can do that actually.
Okay.
So, sir, over to you, sir. Please. Provide your remarks, and afterwards we'll open it up for some questions. Sir, you have to unmute yourself, sir.
Okay, am I audible now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay.
Well, thank you very much. You know, it is a fantastic lecture with a very wide canvas. Covering the several countries in the world, UK, USA, China. It's an amazing sweep of the films, its content, and the presentation, and also relating to the Indian situation and ultimately connecting with his concern of environment. Thank you very much, Suresh Heblikar. It's a very, very enlightening and insightful lecture by you. You know, I am an economist, and we are supposed to be dry people. But I have also edited one book, Visual Arts and Imagery. And I could understand that any forms of expression, either a poetry or a drama or a film or a music, has two components. One is what you want to convey, and that is the content. And the other is how do you convey? That is the way you express. I think any art has these two aspects, the message it contain and the method of expression. And you have very, very rightly brought out in your presentation and your perspective on it, that anything that is expressed through film should capture the reality, should capture the socioeconomic condition of the people. It can't be distance and away and remote from the people. You have emphasized that very, very rightly. And make the people sensitive about the problem of society. Because I have seen some of the film that you have mentioned, Dictator, for example. What a powerful film, you know. It is this comedy, but at the same time, so serious and so emotional. And it gives a very, very strong message of a lack of democracy and rise of dictatorship. Similarly, the Chinese film, I don't remember the name, but you have mentioned it, and I saw it, how a king cleans the palace where he was a king. You know, amazing message that it gives. And you have brought out so very well. I do not know other film. But the message is very, very clear that the content of the film should be such that it should relate to the society, reality, and make the people sensitive to the problem of society. But at the same time, you brought out the method of expression, which I didn't understand much because that's not of my area. But certainly, you know, the forms of expression, a method of expression is equally important. You can have a very good subject and content, and if you present it in a shabby manner, then the people may not accept it, or people will not get involved into it, or will not get absorbed into it. So the way the indicators you have given, and the method of effective expression that you have mentioned as is so powerful. Taking Sam Benegal example and the creation of music by Karanth, you know. So I think this is a wonderful presentation. I thank you on behalf of myself and as well as on behalf of the institute that you have agreed to come. You are going to be associated with the institute now as a board member. I hope that the Dry Economics will, your music and your arts and your perspective will bring some cheers and some changes in the research here. Thank you very much once again. Rajshekhar, please go ahead. People may have a lot of questions. I would like to see some of the films made by Suresh Hemlikar in future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. So now the floor is open, and then I request the people who are participating both online and offline to, if you are online, please unmute yourself and then please ask your question. So I can see that Professor Deshpande is unmuted already. Please go ahead, please.
It was a sheer pleasure listening to you. Am I audible?
Very much, very much.
Yes, it was a sheer pleasure listening to you, and I'm not well, otherwise I would have attended you in person. I have a terrible cough, so I was muting in between. Very nice. It is you as an economist, you have created a matrix which has on the horizontal axis, you have cultural nuances, and on the vertical axis, you have the time series, the time dimension on the vertical axis, and all those sets, small cubes, you have filled them with one or the other type of film. This matrix is one of the very interesting one which I found. I feel I'm concerned with both, with drama film as well as the understanding of the film. You have dealt one aspect of it, that the films that are liked by people like us who are well educated and who have a sense of gratitude towards society. But then the bigger audience is somewhere else, and the bigger audience is the one which drives the cart. That is the problem, because the driving of the cart is done by the pitatle people, in the sense that those who can whistle in the cinema hall are the ones who are leading the film towards a wrong direction, possibly. It is that which need to be having some break somewhere. I feel quite happy. I heard you very patiently, and wonderful lecture. I love both Bivikaran, Charlie Chaplin, every film that you have stated, except one or two I have witnessed, and I really like your incisiveness to get into the film. We are very happy that you are with us, and we are very happy that this year began with the best lecture. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I can see that Professor Kala has unmuted herself. Do you have any question?
Yes, Professor Rajshekhar. You're able to hear me clearly, I hope.
Very well, very well.
Namaskara, Sri Suresh Heblikar avarige. Happy Kannada Rajyotsava tamage. Tumba chennagittu. My name is Kala Sitaram Sridhar. Nanu illi professor agidini, Center for Research in Urban Affairs alli. And this was indeed a very, very fascinating lecture. I'm not a big movie goer at all. but you have persuaded us to actually go to more of your movies and see what the implications are for the environment. Nanke onde one quick question itto sir. Actually, as I said, in the olden days, in the 1960s and 70s, nama Indian movies and Hindi movies, they had a lot of, probably Kannada movies like Ranganayaki also, which you mentioned, they had a lot of artificial setting as their background. I mean, all these heroes and heroines going around the trees and singing and all that was artificial. And that was the time at which the environment probably in India was very, very pure. The air was clean. The water was really drinkable, potable, right? But now, in the 1990s and 2000s, I'm given to understand that the setting used in all these films is actually real. But this is the time at which we are experiencing a lot of environmental degradation. Nama parisara alla tumba pollute agide. So I don't know, does this reflect something on cost considerations for the filmmakers or the directors? I would really like to know about this, sir. Thank you very much. And once again, nimge Kannada Rajyotsavada shubhashayagalu, sir. Thank you.
Professor Lakshmana, you have raised your hand.
ಸರ್ ತುಂಬಾ ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳು ಸರ್. ತಮ್ಮ ಅದ್ಭುತವಾದಂತಹ ಒಂದು ಕನ್ನಡ ರಾಜ್ಯೋತ್ಸವದ ವಿಸ್ತರಣಾ ಭಾಷಣ ತುಂಬಾ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿತ್ತು ಸರ್. ತಮಗೆ ತುಂಬಾ ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳು ಸರ್. ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಕನ್ಸರ್ನ್ ವಿತ್ ವಾಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾಪನಿಂಗ್ ಅಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಮೂಮೆಂಟ್. ಫಾರ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್, ಬೇಸಿಕಲಿ ವಿ ವೇರ್ ಬ್ಲೇಮಿಂಗ್ ದಿ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಪಾಪ್ಯುಲೇಷನ್ ವಿಚ್ ವಾಸ್ ಇನ್ಫ್ಲುಯೆನ್ಸ್ ಟು ದಿ ಎನ್ವೈರನ್ಮೆಂಟ್. But what we have already addressed under the globalization, now the development imperatives have been in place to the environment. For example, increasing the middle class and development imperatives. So that just I want, it is not a question, but whether if there are any such films are available to watch or otherwise, please bring this issue from your films also. These are my just questions, sir, because the changing world, the globalization world, we should not blame the population. For example, basically poverty and high population growth have influenced and human beings, everything, because you have brought in your lecture local to international. So that this is my concern, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Lakshmana. Anyone else? Indira madam, Professor Indira, are you there? Would you like to say something? Okay. And anyone else in the online? Then I will request Mr. Suresh Habrikar to answer these two questions, and then perhaps then we can even kelare ta. Okay, kel kel
ale mane film idiyalla adarli hechu ganigle huvuna balisidiralla so yena nimma nanige ganigle huvu andre adu ond nativity symbol. ಸೊ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಸಿಂಬಲ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ನೀವು ಒಂದು ಬ್ರಾಹ್ಮಣ ಪುರೋಹಿತನ ಮಗಳು ಮತ್ತು ಅವಳ ವಿಧವೆ ಮತ್ತು ಆ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಗಣಗಲೆಯನ್ನ ಎರಡು ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಬಳಸ್ತಾರೆ. ಒಂದು ವಿಧವೆಯ ಒಂದು ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರ ಆದ ನಂತರ ಹಾಕಿ ಎಂದೂ ಗಣಗಲೆ ಹೂ ಮುಟ್ಟಂಗಿಲ್ಲ. ಆದ್ರೆ ನಿಮ್ ಫಿಲ್ಮ್ ನಲ್ಲಿ ಆ ಗಣಗಲೆ ಹೂ
ಮುಟ್ಟಿಸಿದ್ದೀರಾಟಿವಿಟಿ because in that location those flowers were plenty. avaga namma directors igagli film makers igagli adanna yak use martidivi anta gottagilla nijavagi hetu ee one layers olaga avaru vichar madlilla adara. So nanu gottide ad yenen itto, what was the available there, they have used it. Maybe they have used it very well, no doubt about it, because in as we say in environment, localism is important. Using local food, local clothes, nativity and localism, what we say. So similarly, even films also, amalli films yathara martare antandre we bring lot of things from outside. Nan one film alu martide yavdu, there were 40 people came from Bombay in Mysore hotel olaga, then they stayed there for 4 days. Now I asked the director, yake ಇಲ್ಲ ಸರ್ ಫೈಟ್ ಸೀಕ್ವೆನ್ಸ್ ತರ್ತಿದ್ದೀವಿ. ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಟೋಲ್ಡ್ ಮೀ ದಟ್ ಒನ್ ಫ್ರೆಂಚ್ ಫಿಲ್ಮ್ ಇತ್ತು, ರೆಡ್ ಶೂಸ್ ಅಂತ. Adarali, there is an actress. She is a brilliant actress, and she has, explores her art to such an extent that entire Europe will be watching her. So there is a studio. They have become very important, that they make money, and the studio director has an affection for her. So it may be a love or it may be an affection. So Arthur, you have to do that role. And then Tumba convinced Madhira. And Madhira. Amel noted that I live in Nalvatijana fighting at Bakes or Droga. Some of the Indian films, Hanga Marbeka, the Masala Vekala. Then Nan Kail Pistulo Kotro, Madras. Yakri Della Hilil and you, sir, at Beka to the Sahar, Ilan from the audience, not a Latin. So he gave. So ಈ ತರ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಫಿಲ್ಮ್ ಆಗ ನೀವು ಹೇಳಿದ್ರ ಅಲೆಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಅಲೆಮನೆ ಬಿಕೇಮ್ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಇಟ್ ಬಿಕಮ್ ಅ ಬಿಗ್ ಹಿಟ್ ಅದು ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಅ ಬಿಗ್ ಹಿಟ್ ಅನ್ಫಾರ್ಚುನೇಟ್ಲಿ ಬ್ಯೂಟಿಫುಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ಅವರ್ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಅವರ್ ಕ್ಯಾಮರಾಮನ್ ಗೌರಿ ಶಂಕರ್ ಅಂತ ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಅ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಟೆಲಿಜೆಂಟ್ ಮ್ಯಾನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಐ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ಡ್ ದೆಮ್ ಟು ಮೇಕ್ ಅ ಫಿಲ್ಮ್ ಆಲ್ದೋ ದ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟರ್ ವಾಸ್ ದ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಟೈಮ್ He had brought some 6-7 pages. So, ಇದೇ ಎಲ್ಲ ಸ್ಕ್ರೀನ್ ಪ್ಲೇ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು ನನಗೆ ಸೊ ಆ ಸ್ಕ್ರೀನ್ ಪ್ಲೇ ಅಲ್ಲ ಸರ್ ಒಂದು ಕತೆ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದೆ ಎನಿವೇ ಯು ಆರ್ ದ ಗುಡ್ ಮ್ಯಾನ್ ಯು ಲಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಹ್ಯೂಮಿಲಿಟಿ ಅಂಡ್ ಲಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಆನೆಸ್ಟಿ ಇನ್ ಹಿಮ್ ಸೊ ದಟ್ ಫಿಲ್ಮ್ ಬಿಕಮ್ ಅ ಮೇಜರ್ ಹಿಟ್ ಟು ಸಚ್ ಅನ್ ಹಿಟ್ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಅದು ನನಗೆ ಕೆಲವರು ಹೇಳೋದು ಸರ್ ನಮ್ಮ ಕಡೆಗೆ ಅಣ್ಣವ್ರ ಫಿಲ್ಮ್ 4 ವಾರ ಓಡ್ತದೆ ನಿಮ್ದು 6 ವಾರ ಓಡ್ತು ನೋಡಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳೋದು ಸೊ ಐ ಮೀನ್ ಬಟ್ ಅನ್ಫಾರ್ಚುನೇಟ್ಲಿ ದ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸರ್ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಡಿಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ಗೆಟ್ ಎನಿ ಮನಿ Because those days we did not even understand the marketing. Yag market madodu, yelli hogodu, yarge. So yaro marketing they would never pay money. They just went on making money. The distributors were, big thugs in the market. So this is how. But however, the film has remained with a lot of people even today after a long time. Thanks. Correct. No, she is right. I agree with her that environment is very important. That's what I said, maybe wrongly, the socio-economic conditions. Environment plays a basic, that's what he asked me just now a question. Why in Alemane, the girl was used, Ganigeri, who? That particular flower was used by me and also the girl there. But I said locally the flower was in abundance. That growth was abundance. But I wrote an article also about that in Prajavani, saying that that is the biggest lake of Bangalore actually. That Bhairamangala Lake is the biggest lake. And then the British in 1942 built a drinking water reservoir. So you can imagine the entire water was being supplied. I went and met the industry minister when the government decided to put up 2 big industries there. They started chopping the mounds, the hills. And along with the hills, we saw a lot of trees and shrub and grassland was also being wiped out, which I said is going to affect the lake. Because along with these big industries, the auxiliary industries will come up. Because not only big industries will survive, they have to have auxiliary units. And then the shops will come to serve them tea. Then the BD shop will come. Then housings will start. Whatever, rampant housing. And then they will destroy the entire topography of the village. The lake will be gone. This is exactly what I told. I took the Chief Justice, Mr. Chandrasekharan. He was a very, very wonderful man. So I took him to show, sir, this is what is happening. He told me, Suresh, I won't come, but you go and meet the industry minister. You tell him. I knew the industry minister personally, but I told him this. He said, if you keep on talking about environment, how can we develop? He said. I said, I'm not against industry. Because I should have been working in industry, I told him. I'm an economic student. but now I understand that there are a lot of places where you can give. Why do you want only Bangalore? Today, Bangalore is reached a more, it has gone beyond saturation. This Mekedatu, I'm telling you, is the most dangerous project any government that takes. Mekedatu, if you do it, I think in the 2 to 3 years, we will not have enough rain, we will not have enough water. That will be gone. No, the thing is, you see, for instance, the basin, the Kaveri River basin, the banks of this has wonderful forest. The rainfall is there because of the forest only. They are part of the Western Ghat forest. It's an extension of Western Ghat. And then if you remove them, 12,000 hectares of land. Land means whatever the rainfall comes, it has to percolate there. Your groundwater, moisture, agriculture, horticulture, then all other biodiversity has to survive. It's because of the forest. Yes. If you submerge, then what remains? We already see, instead of that, for 9,000 crores which are spending there, if those 9,000 crores can be put to rejuvenate our lakes here, like Magde Road, that big started by in 1932, Mokshugundam Visveshwaraya, JP. Allah, sir, big first lake. We can do that. But there, what has happened, I mean, right from Yetharagatta, there is an overflow of water to that lake. They have put a lot of industries, housing layouts, and all that. Yeah. Tipekundam Hadley. Yeah. But still, we can work on that. We can work on a lot of lakes. We can create some more new lakes, which were the, for instance, the rainwater, what is called, water beds and all that. Watersheds we can create. And then you see, instead of that, we can have local water resources. Groundwater we have to leave. Peri-urban areas we have to maintain and preserve them, so that the rainfall, we can have a lot of rainfall, a lot of flood, I mean, small ponds and lakes and Kalyanis, they can survive. Why, you know, you're spending 9,000 crores here? So this, yes, sir. So this environment, as you said, ma'am, it's very important. And as I said, socio-economic conditions should reflect in the films. Environment gets automatically reflected. Whatever environment. That is why we films represent the cultures of the place, cultures of the land. Any film, if it does not reflect, then it's not a good film. The culture and environment are closely interrelated. Food, clothing, talk, shelter, housing, all these things are parts of our environment and part of our culture. So if we do not show these cultures which reflect or the taking in the environmental conditions, those films will not be very great. That is artificial that we are saying. This artificiality will bring in pretensions in acting, also in direction. That is why they do not become great films.
Mr. Satyaranjan, would you like to ask something? Because you have raised your hand.
Yes, sir. Am I audible clearly?
Yeah, yes, very, very well. Please kindly be brief. Ask your questions, please.
Yes, sir, please. I have two questions, actually. So first is, there are two recent reports. One is the Kasturi Rangan report and Gadgil committee report. So one says that, is it okay if I ask this question, sir?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay. So one says that because of industrial development, we are actually damaging the environment of Western Ghats. And another says that we can improve over it if we use people-centric and geographical area-specific businesses in that area. So what I wanted to know that sir agrees with the advice given by Kasturi Rangan report, or he thinks that industrialization is actually ultimately damaging our Western Ghat and we cannot change it in any way.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Mr. Satyaranjan. You want to ask something, Vidisha? Yeah, please go ahead.
Thank you very much, sir, for this opportunity. Sir, first of all, I would like to congratulate and thank you very much for this thought-provoking lecture. And I am also happy to note that we are having an innovative kind of lecture, unlike traditional. If I may use the word traditional lecture, we are starting new year with an innovative kind of lecture. So on that note, I would like to congratulate and thank you so much, sir. Sir, I have one question. Though from your lecture, we understood that the environment is intertwined with the socio-economic and cultural conditions, but I could not find enough material in your lecture on the kind of development model which we are pursuing. In the name of development model, the environment is getting damaged. And So I would like to hear from you on that particular aspect. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? Either on, okay, please go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful lecture. I have only one question, sir. Question is, what is the responsibility and role of an actor or a director for the society? And one more is, what should be the position of a director when a state is intervening a film? These are the two questions I have. What should be the position of a director when a state is intervening in a film? Suppose they are banding for a... Thank you.
So anything else? This is the last chance, then afterwards we will not have any more opportunity. If anybody wants to ask a question, this is the best time, okay? Offline, yes, sir. Sir, please.
Yeah. Your first question was...
Role.
See, one thing is both actors and directors have to be sensitive. Sensitivity comes with knowledge, with reading. Some people are sensitive basically by nature. And if their skill can be turned into, let's say, filmmaking or acting, if their sensitivity remains, then they can be, that's their duty, to maintain their sensitivity and take it to greater levels, different levels, when they make films. For instance, if you are making a film on, let's say, a traditional life of the society, you have to be honest. You have to be sensitive and commitment. If these three things are there, you will be able to make any good, art into a convincing and a good art. So that is the conditions for both actor as well as director. What you said are the responsibilities. I mean, they don't consider it as responsible. Unfortunately, today we go by money only. Unfortunately, because there was a time when I know when we acted in films, we used to pay money to the director. In the sense, directors were mostly our friends. One or two directors I know that they wanted to drink every day. They didn't have money. Without drink, they would not sleep. Yeah. So we had to give them money to or buy a drink for them. I remember this. So, but we did not feel it. That, you know, we are paying money, we are trying to, no. Because we knew that they were very good, talented people. They were extremely talented. Keeping on track. So, I mean, they have the condition. There are people, my friends I know, some actors, they would not bother even if you go to docs. That was the condition of some actors. They said, let them go and find some other actor. But the true actors are those who would act without even considering whether they are going to be paid or not. I had acted in a film which became a big hit, but I was paid very, very little money. The director, the producer made a lot of money later. But however, he wanted me only to act, and I loved his script because I had not expected that he would write such a wonderful script and he would do that great film. He did it. I'm very happy. But I'm just telling you. So these are some of the things which actors and directors should keep in mind. If you go only after money, I don't think you will turn out to be a great contributor to the society in terms of what you are doing, either acting or direction. Fine. Sir, as far as development is concerned, developmental models, I don't know whether the country has any models of development even today. Well, now we have, let us say, cars. How many cars we should have? We don't have a roadmap for the country. How many cars should be maintained? The carrying capacity of a particular city. The city can carry only so many vehicles, but we have got 10 times more. So why we should produce those so many cars? Cars not only produce this pollution, that is the air pollution, but cars also have an impact on the forests. For instance, if we have more cars in Bangalore, we will be losing more Western Ghats, because Western Ghats where So to get iron ore, you have to cut the forest, chop the forest. For instance, what happened in Bellary, Sondur, you know that. And millions of tons of this iron ore was taken away, sent to China and other countries. So the development models very hard to decide for a country like India, because we say that we are a developing country. People who have money, they will buy cars, and the money will go to some people. That becomes a source of existence, source of employment. So we are looking at that. If we create good employment, forget about development models. So environment is considered as a last bastion for an industrialist. He looks at profit, he looks at his market, he looks at, you know, sustainability of his industry. But whether the industry will sustain, because environment is the base of, environment is the basis of all economic development. That is considered, it should be considered both as for by the developers as well as by the government. That if you lose environment, what I'm meaning is the natural resources which constitute our environment. If you go on exploiting it in such a way that, you know, in times to come, you will not be able to produce what you are producing now. You may produce with maybe, see, for instance, in 1972, the MIT students brought out, they presented, their presentation was, they said that there is a limit to growth. They told the government, you can't just go on producing the way you want and call yourself as a great and rich country, because there is a limit. Then the industrialists and the government said, we will bring in innovations, and the governmental intervention, the scientific interventions will play a role, and they will dematerialize, in the sense, whatever natural resources you are using now, maybe there will be a reduction in that. But whatever it is, he said, the student said, there is a limit to growth. So I have a feeling, I mean, individual feeling, that unless we coin, unless we bring out a new social awareness or an economic awareness for the whole world. For now, America is a country which is spending huge money and all that. But there is a lot of unemployment. There is also a lot of homeless people are there, right? Such a big capitalist country and with richest people there. Even our own Indians are drawing huge salaries and all that. But then that country doesn't listen to the saner voices. It listens to the voice of Apple, listen to the voice of Micro, that Bill Gates, listen to the voice of these people, that Facebook fellow. These are the richest fellows, but they don't know what is happening to the world. They cannot by themselves live in that country for a long time. So that's why we have to create a new economic lesson. The prosperity should not be the ultimate aim of every country. That's what my feeling is today. If you think that you are going to become economically prosperous, you will be environmentally poor. Once you are environmentally poor, you will also come down. Because there is something, you see, 150 countries. Those leaders said, everybody wants car today, smartphones, houses. But how long will the world will maintain this? We are 800 crore people. Today, there is awareness among marginalized sections of the people also. And these aware people, cognizant people, they will say, why you have to have? We also need to have that. So there has to be certain equity in the, you know, the distribution of wealth. So we have to consider all these things and come out. That's why your institute is here. Perhaps you will be able to do that. So as far as I'm concerned, the developing countries cannot have a developmental model. We are looking at reduction of poverty, creation of employment, and talking about sustainability is only a sponsored programs of the companies.
You're right. That's very, I think that was very wonderful response, that sustainability is basically whatever the limited reason this is being used. Thank you very much, sir, for your lecture and other things. So now, can you just organize this one here, and then Illi on the chair axi. So we would like to honor you, sir. Yeah. Illi, Okay. No. See, this is our customer is this one. If you want, no, it's okay. As if you sit here or sit there. So we have come to the last part of our program, and then that's vote of thanks, and that will be proposed by Professor Cyril Lautier, who is the head of CENR in our institute. Over to you, Professor Cyril.
Thank you, so much, sir, for this opportunity, and. Nothing much to say as stated by the director and our chairman, Professor Sukhdev Thorar ji, Professor Deshpande ji. Main Hindi mein bolunga, jo unhone bola ki aapne gagar mein sagar bhar diya. It was really a great lecture and very innovative lecture, I must say. So it's my, I feel truly privileged and honored today to propose vote of thanks. I have few points also. For our further discussion with you, because you will be with us for next many years, so your guidance and support will be always with us for working on very common issues related to society, science, and environment. So, as a chairperson of Kannada Development Committee, I begin my address in Kannada. I love this language, but somehow I'm not so fluent in the language, but nonetheless, ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ನನ್ನ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ. ವಂದನಾರ್ಪಣೆಯನ್ನು ಸಲ್ಲಿಸುವ ಅವಕಾಶ ದೊರಾತಿದಿಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ನನಗೆ ತುಂಬ ಸಂತೋಷವಾಗಿದೆ. ಕನ್ನಡ ರಾಜ್ಯೋತ್ಸವ ಅಂಗವಾಗಿ ಏರು ಪರಿಸಿದ ಚಲನಚಿತ್ರ ಮತ್ತು ಪರಿಸರ ಎಂಬ ವಿಷಯದ ಈ ವಿಸ್ತರಣ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸದಲ್ಲಿ ಭಾಗವಹಿಸಿ ಅಧಿವೇಶನದ ಅಧ್ಯಕ್ಷತೆಯನ್ನು ವಹಿಸಿ ತಮ್ಮ ಅಭಿಪ್ರಾಯಗಳನ್ನು ಹಂಚಿಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದಕ್ಕೆ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಯ ಆಡಳಿತ ಮಂಡಳಿಯ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಅಸ್ತ್ರದ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಸುಖದೇವ ಥೋರಾಟ್ ಅವರಿಗೆ, ನಿರ್ದೇಶಕ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ರಾಜಶೇಖರ್ ಹಾಗೂ ಐಸೆಕ್ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಯ ಮತ್ತು ಕನ್ನಡ ಅಭಿವೃದ್ಧಿ ಸಮಿತಿಯ ಪರವಾಗಿ ನನ್ನ ಹೃದಯಪೂರ್ವಕ ಬಂಧನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಅರ್ಪಿಸುತ್ತೇನೆ. ಸರ್ ಥೋರಾಟ್ ಅವರ್ ಚೇರ್ಮನ್ ಸರ್, ಆಪ್ಕೊ ಶಾಯದ್ ಕನ್ನಡ ನಹೀ ಆತಿ ಹೋಗಿ, ಮೈ ಆಪ್ಕೊ ಬತಾ ದೇತಾ ಹೂಂ, ಹಮಾರಾ ಅಭಿಪ್ರಾಯ ಯೇ ಹೈ ಕಿ ಹಮ್ ಆಪ್ಕಾ ಹೃದಯ ಸೇ ಅಭಿವಾದನ್ ಕರ್ತೆ ಹೈ, ಆಪ್ಕೆ ಹೃದಯ ಸೇ ಆಭಾರಿ ಹೈ ಕಿ ಆಪ್ಕಾ ಹಮೇ ಮಾರ್ಗದರ್ಶನ ಮಿಲ್ತಾ ಹೈ, ಔರ್ ಆಪ್ನೆ ಇಸ್ ಏಕ್ ಬಹುತ್ ಹೀ ವಿಶಿಷ್ಟ ಲೆಕ್ಚರ್ ಕಿ ಅಧ್ಯಕ್ಷತಾ ಆಜ್ ಕಿ, ಔರ್ ಆಪ್ನೆ ಲೆಕ್ಚರ್ ಕೋ ಸಮರೈಜ್ ಭೀ ಕಿಯಾ, ಉಸ್ಕೋ ಮೈ ದುಬಾರಾ ಸೇ ರಿಪೀಟ್ ಭೀ ನಹೀ ಕರೂಂಗಾ. ಬಹುತ್ ಬಹುತ್ ಧನ್ಯವಾದ್ ಸರ್. ಇಂದು ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ರಾಜ್ಯೋತ್ಸವ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸವನ್ನು ನಡೆಸಿಕೊಟ್ಟ ನಮ್ಮ ಗೌರವಾನ್ವಿತ ಅತಿಥಿಗಳು ಪರಿಸರ ಸಂಬಂಧಿ ಚಿತ್ರಗಳನ್ನು ಮತ್ತು ಚಲನಚಿತ್ರಗಳನ್ನು ನಿರ್ಮಿಸಿ ನಿರ್ದೇಶನ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇವರು ಹೆಸರುವಾಸಿ ಆಗಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಮತ್ತು ಜನಪ್ರಿಯವಾಗಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಹಾಗೂ ಸ್ನೇಹಮಯ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿತ್ವ ಇರುವ ಶ್ರೀ ಸುರೇಶ್ ಹೆಬ್ಲಿಕಾರ್ ರವರೇ, ನಿಮಗೆ ಧನ್ಯವಾದ ಅರ್ಪಿಸುವುದಕ್ಕೆ. ನನಗೆ ತುಂಬ ಸಂತೋಷವಾಗುತ್ತದೆ. ನಿಮ್ಮ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸವು ನಮ್ಮ ಆಲೋಚನೆಯ ಪ್ರಕ್ರಿಯೆ ಮೇಲೆ ತುಂಬ ಪರಿಣಾಮವನ್ನು ಬೀರಿದೆ. ನಿಮ್ಮ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸವು ನಮಗೆ ಚಲನಚಿತ್ರದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ತುಂಬ ವಿಷಯಗಳನ್ನು ತಿಳಿಸಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿದೆ. ಮತ್ತೊಮ್ಮೆ ಹೃದಯಪೂರ್ವಕ ವಂದನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಅರ್ಪಿಸುತ್ತೇನೆ. Sir, I will not summarize your lecture, as our respected chairman has given the gist what you have spoken and followed by Professor Deshpande. But I will mention a few points which I read from your contribution and available in public platform. Also briefly introduced by my colleague while giving a brief introduction of you. You have rightly pointed out in many platforms that today we are in a world of entertainment, but what kind of entertainment the films provide must be properly ascertained. You have pointed out during your lecture also. In the era of highly uncertain world, driven and influenced by a variety of unprecedented happenings, just to give example of current pandemic, coupling with global environmental change, socioeconomic change, you have pointed out during your lecture, the films or filmmaking should make us look at the society in a creative and deeper way with hope and problem solving ideas. I think that's some where it's getting delineated. Meantime, audience also needs to change and take a look at the real cinema, which could give a lots of sense and ideas an impression that film are not just tapes of fun and frolic, but also are an effective medium of communication for problem solving. Sir, I remember, now I will take you to Uttarakhand. I come from Uttarakhand. Uttarakhand is facing very acute problem of out migration. And there was a film named Sunpat. Sunpat means silent touches. And this is an important film made on social problem facing Uttarakhand, which I mentioned, out migration. And this film is about the loneliness felt by older generation in Uttarakhand. Even the nature, mountains and agriculture, everyone, even mountains feels themselves very lonely when the society is leaving them. And film says that this bordering state, without human intervention, in bordering states, social and ecological environment seems to be in jeopardy. How to conserve,
environment without people in this state, which is highly fragile and vulnerable. Sir, this has made life-changing impact in the youth, in the minds of youth, that reverse migration took place. And villages are getting rejuvenated. So this is a great, yeah. Yes, sir, yeah. Yes, yeah, yes, sir. So this is the impact of the film. We do agree creating the thought-provoking stories in films and filmmaking. And filmmaking have contributed a lot in all the fields and will continue in same way in future. Sir, once again, I thank you for kindly accepting our request to deliver Karnataka Rajyotsava lecture at ISEC and enriching our knowledge in this field. I learned a lot, and as my colleague, Professor Kala Sitaram Sridhar, has pointed out that I'm not so much inclined to go to the cinema, but definitely now onwards, I will definitely very meticulous and objective which movie to be seen and watched by us for making ourselves rich so that we could contribute something in environmental conservation. I would like to extend our sincere thanks to the respected board members, the directors, former director of ISEC, Professor R.S. Deshpande, invitees for their participation in the lecture. I extend our sincere thanks to Director ISEC, Professor D. Rajasekhar, under whose able and dynamic leadership, Karnataka Rajyotsava Extension Lecture at ISEC has been organized. And this is, as many of have pointed, that this is a very new to us to have this kind of lecture in this. It is first of its own kind, as Professor Deshpande has pointed out. Thank you so much, sir, for giving a very able leadership and dynamic and vibrant academic leadership to the institute. I thank my colleague, Professor Krishna Raj, for his inputs in organization of Karnataka Rajyotsava Extension Lecture. I thank ISEC faculty, the registrar, ISEC Sri Ashok Rao, accounts and registrar section, students, research staff, and entire ISEC fraternity for making this event a great success and participation in the same. My dear friend Satish Kamath deserves our special thanks and appreciation for making us updated in this digitized world. Sir, as the lecture has given lots of thought-provoking ideas under the arena of film and environment, basically broader environment to be thought in detailed perspective and deeper perspective, and cannot be understood properly until unless we understand the micro environment, and then we understand meso and then macro. So first of all, we need to understand the micro environment in a very meticulous and scientific manner. Micro environment is the root for making the macro environment safe and secure. So I take it to the micro environment. ISEC is one of the best example of making micro environment rich and healthy. Sir, you'll be happy to note that we are one of the best maintained and biodiversity rich campuses in Bangalore. Having less than 50 acres of land, we hold 400 plant species on the campus and many faunal species. This is properly documented. All are well maintained and conserved with utmost care and proper landscaping. We have landscaping expert with us, Professor Seth Pandey. And for this, I must thank our gardeners for their dedicated work. Our gardeners, they do work day in and day out with lots of affection in making our campus so beautiful and a micro biodiversity hotel. This is about our campus. At the end, sir, I would like to mention that ISEC faculty, students, and staff are working on various related to contemporary socio-ecology environment. We'll be very happy to have our collaboration with your esteemed organization, ECOWAS. I am sure that in future, we'll have opportunity to work in close coordination. Fortunately, lots of funding is available. And nowadays, what government of India also wants, government of Karnataka also wants, government-funded institutions should collaborate with the non-governmental organization and self-funded organization. That is the mandate. And many projects are supported in a way so that all the organizations can come together for problem solving in the real world. Sri Suresh Hoblikarji, sir, academic institutions, I mentioned that they have potential to contribute environmental conservation of the agroecological regions in which they are located. So can we just reflect upon for the filmmaking, how to make people, students, scientists aware in this direction? Another thing, sir, what I like from your lecture is the tradition. Aswat Katte, Aswath Katte, an important cultural heritage of ours in Karnataka, has contributed a lot. And our city partly is really green, and then we must acknowledge a culture, deep rooted culture, which we have inculcated in us. So, the film on this, that what is the purpose of Aswath Katte, and how not only in Karnataka, all over Karnataka, but unfortunately, young generation is not so keen to understand this. So, can we make a kind of a film? You know, we all will contribute together so that our young generation would be motivated to come forward in this direction. Two or three points more, sir. This is a decade of ecological restoration, and India has found the bone challenge that we need to rejuvenate or rehabilitate 26 million hectares of land by the end of 2030. But unfortunately, India is a repository of biodiversity. We have such a rich culture, ecologically rich culture, which has proven and given the ideas to the world that what is the meaning of conservation in core area, buffer area. And UNESCO has taken the insight from our sacred group, Devarkado, to be implemented in many vulnerable ecosystems all around the world, particularly in the hot spots, that these are the top-down approach of conservation, and the landscape is deliberately several paths, created lot many conflicts. But we did not learn anything from Devarkado. Devarkado have contributed a lot in conservation and preservation of pristine ecosystems in my country. Unfortunately, they are declining scale and numbers. So can we do something in this direction together? We have been working in Devarkado, in Western Ghats, in Himalaya. We'll be very happy to work with your organization, sir. So agrobiodiversity conservation. I think agrobiodiversity, our state is the home of millets, but agrobiodiversity and land bases under various crops are at the verge of extinction. And declining agrobiodiversity has serious consequences on environment, definitely. I'll not go into the details. And then purpose, that how to conserve agrobiodiversity? We need to eat more. We need to eat more than we can conserve. If we don't eat, then we will not, nobody will conserve. Against to the natural biodiversity. Natural biodiversity means we need to conserve, we need to consume less, we need to protect. But agrobiodiversity, we need to consume lot. And what is happening now? Food habit is changing. And unfortunately, we are not discussing our local food. Sir, we have prepared a paper on this, how changing food habits and ignoring our local food has impacted the flow from the ecosystem services in negative way. So this also, we will be very happy to work with you, sir. Household. Yeah, we will.
Yes, written everything in Vijay Karnataka. Okay. Recently at on those things.
Sure, sir. Yeah. So we will definitely look into this and then work. Sir, one more last point. As I mentioned before, household carbon footprint. Processed food is emitting. People who are eating processed food emitting 50% more to the earth atmosphere in terms of the household carbon footprint. And this is 50% more as compared to the families having local Indian diet. So I think these kind of issues are to be tackled very systematically. And I'm sure that your support, your guidance, and your ideas will help us to make some of the documentaries influencing the mindset of the youth and the people in our country, minds of the stakeholders. So with this, sir, thank you very, very much once again for your thought-provoking lecture, the lecture which really opened up many things in the mind, that how to inculcate many things so that we can develop some kind of visible and documentary is what we have been doing in the various agroecological regions of our country. We will be definitely taking the new dimensions, new arena into our field offices. Thank you very much. I wish you all a very great evening. And once again, Happy New Year. Thank you so very much for this opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Sunil, for that extensive vote of thanks. I just would like to tell that I thank Professor Krishnaraj for suggesting you to deliver this year's Kannada Rajyotsava lecture. So thank you very much. And then as Sunil has pointed out, we have several persons who are interested in environment, and we are particularly happy that you have become a member of BOG, and then we are excited and about the possibility or excited about the possibilities that this offers to interact with you, and then in taking the research, the interaction between the researcher and then activists in the environment, and also a artist, the three dimensions together. So we're just very happy. So once again, thank you very much, sir. And then now, so thank you very much for all of you, those who are on online, offline, and all those things. Okay. So we will, we are missing you. We are taking some group photo here. And then, so you can virtually enjoy Professor Deshpande. So we would have loved to have you with us here, but because of your cold.
I really miss it.
Yeah.
I didn't want you to catch it. That is the reason.
Yeah, yes. So nowadays.
But it's a wonderful lecture. And Professor Ashekar.
Yes, sir.
Way back about 5-6 years back, sorry, 10 years back, I had asked Heblikar to make a film of Isaac.
Okay, okay.
Do you recollect?
Sculpture of reflecting 50 years of development of Isaac.
Okay,
so,
okay.
Bangalore University professor has agreed. Hmm. And he may come down here and he may discuss how to create that one.
Hmm. You can see the painting which I had done.
Yeah, yeah.
Please show him the painting which is correct, on the right side. That
yes,
is
sir,
Isaac totally.
Yeah, yeah.
That is the representation of Isaac.
Correct, sir, correct. I would like to show that painting also.
Thank you.